CFR exists, the Trilateral Commission exists, and it's a, quote, conspiracy of ideas. This is an ideological battle. Some people believe in globalism. Others of us believe in national sovereignty.
We can do these things if you're ready for change. But I want to make sure you understand what that means, because we started talking about change at the beginning of this campaign. We talked about change when we were up. We talked about change when we were down. But I noticed this change thing must be catching on. Because suddenly everybody's talking about change. And that's okay. We all want to be on the change bandwagon, but I think it's important for you to know the arguments that are being made.
And what they know is that the name George W. Bush will not be on the ballot. George Bush won't be on the ballot. The name of my cousin, Dick Cheney, will not be on the ballot.
You spoke to Mr. Obama about this this shared experience?
Cousin Barack? No, we haven't had the opportunity to talk about it.
You haven't once? You call him up and say, well, heck, there's a family tree?
I didn't know whether that would help him or hurt him, so I thought I'd probably stay away from it. So,
the reason why there's such enormous interest during this campaign season is because people are aware that next November they're going to be going into the polling place and they're going to be selecting the next leader of the free world, the next president of the United States.
The focus then was on sustainable growth and global development. It was pointed out at the conference that growth is most efficiently managed by the private sector, but regulation of the process by national governments and international bodies is also needed. And once again, the United Nations should certainly be among the catalysts and coordinators of this process.
Welcome. Let's start with a question. What do higher oil prices, drought, hurricanes, and growing prosperity in China and India all have in common? The answer, they all help to dramatically increase the price of food. Yes, food, by as much as 50% across the board last year. And tonight there's an urgent warning from the United Nations World Food Programme that a crisis point is near. Simply put, there simply isn't enough money to buy food for the millions who need it most. And if more money isn't found, then food aid in some places may have to be rationed or even halted.
Economic growth is, of course, an inevitable corollary of a growing population and is essential to improved standards of living. But without careful coordination, unrestrained economic growth poses further threats to our environment.
Environmental issues are going to be critical. If we want to get a handle on climate change, we've got to give incentives to poor countries to do what they need to do at the same time as we are doing what we need to do in terms of reducing global warming, and that will cost some money.
We'll also ensure that all polluters pay based on the amount of pollution they release into the sky. It's called the 100% auction, so that people can't game the system.
Yay!
Well, this is something that I've made a priority. We are going to double foreign aid. We are going to make the Millennium Development Goals America's goals.
And from the moment I take office as president, I will personally reach out to the leaders of the biggest carbon-emitting nations and ask them to join America in creating a new global energy forum that will lay the foundation for the next generation of climate protocols, and those will be protocols that America will meet.
And finally, just training people, doctors, nurses, teachers, creating a human infrastructure that can sustain development so that we are not simply always coming in, parachuting in, and providing short-term relief, but we're really building capacity on the ground. That's something that I want to invest in heavily.
Ironically, however, the very innovations that are making possible dramatic improvements in human well-being are also creating new problems, which raise the specter of an alarming and possibly catastrophic disaster to the biosphere we live in. And herein lies the dilemma that we all face.
Due to the large number of people arriving, you will experience a short delay. Please be bound to cooperate so that we can process you into the camp faster. Attention, attention, attention. Due to the large number of people arriving, you will experience a short delay. Please remain calm and cooperate so that we can process you into the camp faster.
Please
cooperate with all personnel.
The recent UN meeting in Cairo is appropriately focused on one of these key issues, population growth. But the controversies which have erupted at the conference illustrate the problem of coming to grips with issues that are deeply divisive and which have a profound moral dimension. The United Nations can and should play an essential role in helping the world find a satisfactory way of stabilizing world population and stimulating economic development in a manner that is sensitive to religious and moral considerations.
I'm very glad to see that the humanitarian assistance is going well. When the police can't handle it, they just call in the foreign troops.
Hey, I want the duck in the garden! But, duck! Leave me up, man.
That is absolutely critical, and that's one of the things that I think I can do better than any other presidential candidate, in part because, you know, I've got a grandmother who lives in a little village in Africa without running water, electricity, that's been devastated by HIV/AIDS, that's constantly affected by malaria. These are things that I understand intimately and personally.
Humans injected with a tiny chip holding the key to all of their private information.
But as you're about to see in our CBS 46 investigation, it's not fiction. In fact, it's being marketed in Georgia as life-saving technology. So why do some experts say it's potentially deadly?
It's called RFID technology, or radio frequency identification. Small chips that store information.
So here's the chip.
And now that same technology is literally available in the flesh, with chips injected right into people's arms.
It says it burns a little bit. That's about it.
Being very forgetful, she would ask the time and repeat the questions over and over again.
Which is why Ida is one of the first patients at this Alzheimer's Center in Florida to be implanted with a microchip.
When an Alzheimer patient presents in an emergency room or is found wandering in a certain location, once their arm is scanned, it would immediately designate who they are, their identity, and the fact that they are an Alzheimer patient.
The VeriChip is the size of a grain of rice. It has a 16-digit identification number which gets scanned at a hospital. When the number is put into a database, it can provide crucial medical information.
If you get lost, we can find you, and also if you ever have any medical problems, we'll be able to get some information about you.
And we are going to make development around the world a topmost priority for the Obama administration.
We have a national ID card on our doorsteps. It's being implemented right now. We have FISA courts. We have warrantless searches. We've lost habeas corpus. We've had secret prisons around the world, and we have torture going on. That's un-American, and we need to use the power of the presidency to get it back in order to take care of us and protect this country and our liberties.
Thank you.